So welcome. Thanks very much for coming. My name's Jennifer Valentino. I'm a reporter at the Wall Street Journal. And for the past couple years, I've been covering privacy and surveillance issues. And it is a good time to cover this because of precisely what we are going to be discussing today, this very timely conversation. The falling cost of surveillance is making a lot of these surveillance and tracking tools more prevalent, and that means more stories for me and a lot more things to think about for these guys here. We're going to start out with an introduction by Ashkan Soltani and Kevin Bankston. Ashkan is has most recently been working with the Washington Post on their coverage of NSA surveillance. And before that, he worked at a much cooler paper, the Wall Street Journal, working with us as our technical advisor on our privacy work. He's also been at the FTC and has his master's from Berkeley. On technology and privacy issues. And next to him is Kevin Bankston. They work together on the paper we'll be discussing today. He's the policy director here at New America's Open Technology Institute. And he's kind of made the rounds of the freedom and technology initiatives in both here in DC and in San Francisco, working also at the Center for Democracy and Technology and for quite a while at EFF, the Electronic Frontier Foundation. So I will turn it over to Ashkan, I think, first to discuss his work, and then we'll have a discussion with some other panelists and open it up to questions.
Hey everyone, thanks for coming. I'm going to start just briefly, kind of going back to this case. I'm sure most people are probably familiar with this case. This is a landmark Supreme Court decision, U.S. versus Jones. And the question they were grappling with was whether 28 days of continuous GPS surveillance constituted a search under the Fourth Amendment. And the holding was that, in fact, it did. Attaching a device to a vehicle to monitor its locations was a search. And a lot of the opinion hinged on the physical attachment of the device to the vehicle, and I'll let my colleague speak to the legal aspects. But there was two concurring opinions by Sotomayor and also by Alito outlining kind of location surveillance and our reasonable expectation of privacy. And shortly after this, there was a Supreme Court hearing which one of Chris's colleagues spoke at on, you know, why this GPS surveillance or why this type of surveillance is a search. And I'll kind of let the congressman kind of go through this line.
Mr. Chairman, Ms. Crump, it's been a while since I studied constitutional law or search and seizure. What is the standard required for physical surveillance if law enforcement just wants to follow someone?
The Supreme Court has set different standards for physical surveillance and electronic surveillance. Physical surveillance, the Supreme Court has not required a warrant based on probable cause to carry out.
That's what I thought. So you can follow someone in their car without meeting any standard of proof?
That's right. And I think,
what about airspace surveillance?
I think that's a similar rule. The line that Justice Alito...
I'm not going there yet. We're not there yet. I'm just asking you about physical surveillance, both on land and air. And there's no probable cause requirement for either.
That's certainly correct.
So this line of kind of questioning goes on. And Catherine is actually a great sport. She goes through it. But the rep raised an important question, which is, what's the difference, right? Like, you can always follow someone around on foot or by car or by airplane. Why do these technologies, like, what makes them different such that there is now a search requirement or a search standard required for enabling them? And so the obvious answer was maybe money, right? And so that was my thinking. So I did a quick talk on this topic, kind of right after this hearing, actually, like, same day, actually, back of the envelope calculations, which then Kevin and I decided to kind of write an entire paper about, around what's the difference on the cost of surveillance. And so, kind of the basic argument is, can we calculate the cost per hour for tracking an individual's location? And here we're looking at the cost to acquire the information, and we're not we're not counting fixed cost of purchasing equipment, because presumably once you have the equipment, there's a little barrier to using it other than either the law or the cost. And so we kind of look at kind of the most basic approach, which is foot pursuit, right? So an FBI agent, here we have Keanu Reeves in Point Break, can always follow you around on foot. They could easily just follow an individual around and kind of doing kind of some back of the envelope calculations using the average salary of an FBI agent, field agent with benefits, comes to something to around $50 an hour for an individual agent to follow you around. But he's got obvious limitations. He's got to go to sleep, eat, stop, you know, human factors. And so conducting 24-hour surveillance is difficult for one individual, not to mention to do it covertly. It's difficult for just the same person to track you for 28 days. Auto pursuit is also possible. We can look at how much it would cost for, you know, two officers in a car to follow you, and we came up with a number of about something like $105 an hour based on the officer's salaries plus the kind of gas and maintenance costs for the vehicle using kind of IRS standard deduction plus the average mile expected to be driven. And then we looked at a technique that the FBI uses to perform covert surveillance, and this is called the floating box is what it's termed as, where they have multiple vehicles rotating in a way that essentially prevents the kind of the suspect from realizing they're being surveilled, and this allows them to factor cars in and out, take breaks, etc. And that comes out to something around $275 an hour. Kind of not very advanced math, but just some basic calculations. We kind of threw in, we didn't actually include this in the paper, but we also did it for helicopters and for drones. For drones, we used the number from a recent Senate hearing where I think it was a sheriff from Utah that quoted their hourly operating costs, but helicopters are something like $600 an hour. Drones are a bit cheaper, you know, to acquire and to follow someone around by a drone usually takes one person operating, and the drone does the surveillance themselves. We then started looking at some of the kind of technical means that the police use, and this is a kind of an 80s technology. I couldn't find an example of a picture, but it's essentially like this guy holding a divining rod, where essentially, there's an officer in the car holding an antenna, and there's a device placed on the car that they call it a bumper beeper or a beeper. And as long as you have reasonable line of sight or reasonable kind of distance from the device, you can track its location. So it allows them to maintain a distance from the suspect and thereby reduce the number of agents required to track the individual. And we came down to the number about $105 to $113 an hour, depending on the duration. And the variance is the time it's required to install the device and remove the device. Otherwise, the hourly cost is essentially the same as the two-car scenario, where two agents, one holding the antenna and one driving. We also looked at IMSI Catcher. This is kind of a graphic from, I think, a story Jennifer did on this technology that the police use to locate phones, and it's very much like the beeper technology, except they don't have to install the device. They just use your existing cell phone to triangulate location or to find location from a moving vehicle, like a van. So here, two agents, one to drive, one to manage the equipment, and the operating cost of the car. So far, these are essentially human costs in these technologies, and I think Kevin will touch on what the kind of legal implications are, but these are kind of ballpark numbers to give you an idea. Now we look at a technology that is more widely used more recently, which is GPS devices. This is the kind of device or one of the types of device that was used in U.S. v. Jones. And these devices often attach to the car. They either wire to the car battery or they have their own power source. And again, here, once the device is attached, there is basically a service contract that law enforcement can use that essentially is able to track the device as it moves around. So the device uploads its location continuously to a web interface or a portal interface that the agents can use. And those costs have dropped from, say, the $105 an hour for the beeper or MC catcher to something like $10 an hour to do one day of surveillance, or even $0.36 an hour for a 28-day surveillance using this device, right? So pretty significant drop in cost. We also looked at mobile tracking, so the cell tower tracking that the carriers provide. So, you know, all of the carriers now allow law enforcement to ping individual cell phones and find an individual's location based on their cell phone signal using triangulation of cell phone tower or cell phone tower dumps. And these are approximate numbers that were reported to the ACLU. They're available on their site. But those numbers come down to somewhere from $5 an hour to something like 4 cents an hour to track a cell phone using the kind of the existing cellular infrastructure. So somewhere, you know, somewhere, these vary based on the carrier and the duration, but significantly lower than the traditional methods of tracking. And so this is kind of a breakdown of the costs. You know, so we at the top we have foot pursuit at $50 an hour, $250 for covert foot pursuit, $275 for covert car pursuit, down to something like 4 cents an hour to track someone on for an entire month on Sprint, right? And so these things are, you know, to the question of what's the difference between those technologies, these costs are significantly different. And not just the cost per hour, but also the capacity, right? So one thing to look at, and I'll probably end right after this slide, shortly after the decision, there was a panel in which Julie Angon, one of our colleagues, covered. The FBI stated that they had 3,000 devices out in the field at the time, and they had to request approval to turn the devices back on so they could collect them. It's kind of a funny story because, you know, they couldn't go get their device because of the case. But that aside, it indicated that at that point in time there was at least 3,000 devices in the field, right? And one of the things to realize is under this rubric, right, if you need 5 agents per car or 5 person per agents per target to covertly surveil an individual, that would require 15,000 agents, right? The FBI currently has 13,000 special agents that could actually do this work, somewhere around 13,000. So they did not actually have the capacity. If none of the agents slept, ignored all their other work, ignored food and bathroom breaks, they would still not have the capability to do even 3,000 simultaneous targeting or surveillance of 3,000 simultaneous individuals at any given time. So kind of not only are the costs significantly lower, but the actual capacity or the ability to ratchet up capacity is also significantly changed by these reductions of cost. And so this is kind of just an overview of the difference in cost. So it might be a little hard to see, but for example, that top line, 53X, so cell phone tracking is at its most expensive. So this is, remember, it could be for 1 day of tracking, not 28 days. For 1 day of tracking, cell phone tracking is still 53 times cheaper or less expensive than to traditional covert car tracking, or 22 times cheaper than IMSI catcher-based tracking, or something like half as cheap as GPS tracking. So this is basically a way to try to visualize the difference in cost between the different technologies. Wait.
Do you want to go ahead and, since we're bringing up the screen, you can bring up the other folks.
With Ashkan and Kevin today, we've got some panelists who will give us their perspective on the issue of economics and surveillance. So in the middle there is Christopher Segoyan, and he's the principal technologist at the ACLU, and in 2012, I believe, received his PhD from Indiana University focusing on tech companies and their facilitation of surveillance, and he tends to, somewhat like Ashkan, approach this from a technical perspective, unlike the lawyers on this panel, which who are also very technical, but not quite.
Lots of them. As lawyers go. Yeah.
Right. Yes. Exactly. We have Mark Zwillinger, the founder of Zwillgen PLLC, and he's a specialist in internet law. So, as we said. among lawyers, very technical, particularly ECPA, the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, FISA, which has been in the news a lot lately with the NSA surveillance, and notably he represented Yahoo in 2008 in a case about the precursor to FISA. And finally, last but not least, we have Oren Kerr, a professor at George Washington University Law School, who also writes extensively on Fourth Amendment issues and computer crime law. And both he and Mark were formerly at the DOJ. Oren was an attorney on computer crime law in particular. So I think Kevin can start us out.
Sure. Thank you, Jennifer, and thanks to everyone who joined us for this panel. Thanks to everyone in the audience and everyone who tuned in on the live stream, to use an anachronistic term. And thanks to Ashkan for laying out the basic trend line of the falling cost of surveillance. What I'm going to do in hopefully 10 minutes, probably more like 15 minutes, give you the legal context for that technological and economic research and introduce the legal ideas in our paper. And in the process, hopefully give some context for the current NSA controversy that'll be helpful. Speaking of our paper, I don't think we've mentioned the title of it yet. It's a paper that was published in January with the Yale Law Journal Online called Tiny Constables and the Cost of Surveillance, Making Sense, as in cents in a dollar, of US v. Jones, because we just can't pass up bad puns. And if you're wondering why it's called Tiny Constables, I'll explain that very shortly. But I'm going to start with again, I can't pass up a bad pun. Although actually no pun was intended. So I'm going to start first with a whirlwind magical mystery tour, to make it sound really exciting, of the modern Fourth Amendment, which is actually a pretty sordid tale of bootleggers and bookies and harassing phone calls and, of course, drugs. Lots of drug cases. The Fourth Amendment, if you're not familiar with it, although if you're watching or in the room, I expect you are, is our primary protector of privacy against the government. It protects our persons, our papers, our effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. And searches and seizures without a warrant based on probable cause are presumably unreasonable. And the Fourth Amendment requires that warrants only be issued with probable cause and particularly describing what's going to be searched or seized. But before the 1960s and the birth of modern Fourth Amendment doctrine, the Fourth Amendment was very physical and property-based, turning on whether, and the question of whether you had been searched or you had something of yours had been seized, turned mostly on whether your private space had been violated in some way. Did they go into your bag? Did they go into your house or your office? And this is particularly evidenced in the Supreme Court's first tangle with wiretapping as an investigative technique in a case called Olmstead v. U.S., involving a bootlegger named Olmstead in his bootlegging shack, which, progressive for the time, like he had phone. He had a phone in his shack out in the woods where he was bootlegging. And so the FBI attached some alligator clips to his phone line to do a wiretap and listen to what he was saying. And so he tried to get this evidence against him suppressed under the Fourth Amendment. And the Supreme Court said, no, this was not a search. This did not implicate your Fourth Amendment rights because they didn't actually enter your house or otherwise violate your private space. You sent these electrical impulses out into the world, and so they were not protected. And so for over 40 years, the Fourth Amendment did not protect against wiretapping by the government. What I would view as a mistake, and one that wasn't corrected until 1967, in what's considered the birth of modern Fourth Amendment law, a case called Katz v. U.S. v. Katz, rather, which instead of a bootlegger involved a bookie named Katz in New York who had a particular phone booth that he liked to use a lot for his bookmaking. And there, the cops attached an eavesdropping device, a microphone, to the outside of the phone booth to eavesdrop on his calls. And the government argued, hey man, under Olmstead, this is not a violation of his privacy, this is not a search, because we did not violate the private space of the closed phone booth. And in a very important decision, the Supreme Court said, we are overruling Olmstead. We are deciding here and now that, no, the Fourth Amendment doesn't protect places. The Fourth Amendment protects people. And in particular, it protects people's reasonable expectation of privacy, which has come to be defined as if you have a subjective belief that something is private, and that belief is one that society would deem to be reasonable, although how one decides that is a difficult question that we'll talk about, then you have a reasonable expectation of privacy, and a violation of that expectation is a search under the Fourth Amendment. This important principle was somewhat limited in a way that's very relevant to the NSA dispute in a case in the 70s called Smith v. Maryland, which this time involved a thief who was making harassing phone calls to the person he had stolen from. And so the government conducted a type of surveillance called a pen register to track what phone numbers this suspect was dialing in order to prove that he was, in fact, calling the person who was being harassed. And so a pen register is literally the device that one would place on a phone line to collect the impulses and then print it out on a piece of paper, you know, dashes and dots to indicate the numbers that were being dialed. Anyway, the Supreme Court looked at this and they said, we actually don't think this is a cat's type situation. We don't think this is a search. We don't think this is a violation of privacy, because when you dialed the phone number, you were communicating it to the phone company so they could connect your call. And when you exposed that information to the phone company, just like, as they said in an earlier case in the 70s, when you hand over records to the bank, when you engage in a transaction with your bank, you've assumed the risk that they're going to share that information with the government. You have voluntarily exposed that information with a third party, and you've assumed the risk that they'll share it. So no violation of your privacy, no warrant required. This has come to be known as the assumption of risk doctrine, or when it deals with records, the third party records doctrine, and is the primary defense of the NSA's metadata collection program. So that brings us to location tracking in the 80s, and a couple of cases called Caro and Knotts, where the Supreme Court looked at the issue of when the government uses a bumper beeper, as Ashkan described, to track someone around on the public roads. Is that a search? And in those cases, in both cases, they didn't actually attach something to the bumper. They placed beepers in the barrels that carried precursor chemicals for making drugs. So they basically secreted a tracking device in the barrels that the drug dealer slash manufacturers were moving around. And then they would follow in relatively close proximity, tracking with a radio device to make sure that they could maintain the surveillance even if they lost immediate visual contact. And in both of these cases, the Supreme Court concluded that, well, they were in public. These cars were in public. Those movements were, you know, voluntarily and knowingly exposed to the public. And so these suspects assumed the risk that they would be seen, including by the cops. And the fact that the cops somewhat automated this process and it enabled them to follow at a longer distance or whatever did not actually impact the Fourth Amendment analysis. Now, in one of the cases, the beeper was brought inside of a private space. And in that instance, they found that that tracking while it was in a private space was a search. But doing the tracking on the public roads wasn't. Which brings us to the landmark case of US v. Jones that Ashkan talked about. Frankly, it would be more of a landmark if it were actually clearer. Instead, it's a very confused opinion with a lot of different opinions in it. Again, drug dealers, a common feature of many Fourth Amendment cases. Attachment of GPS device to drug dealer's car, and continuous monitoring of that GPS device for 28 days. Question, does this implicate the Fourth Amendment? Is this a search that violates a reasonable expectation of privacy? Scalia wrote a majority opinion, signed on to by four others, that didn't address the question of the tracking, but instead found that the attachment of the device was the Fourth Amendment moment and constituted a search. Justice Alito wrote a opinion signed on to by four of his colleagues, signed on to by three of his colleagues, rather, that decried the Scalia opinion as a return to Olmstedian physical-based Fourth Amendment thinking and said, no, the real issue is the tracking. And we think this tracking is different from the tracking in Caro and Knotts, and I'll talk about why shortly. And using logic that I'll talk about in a couple minutes, decided, no, this tracking violated the Fourth Amendment. And then finally, Sotomayor, sort of, you know, uniter, not divider, she agreed with both of them. She wrote a concurring opinion. She signed on to the Scalia opinion saying, I think that the attachment of the device violated the Fourth Amendment. And then she wrote a concurring opinion that also said, I agree with Alito and the signers of his opinion that this violated the Fourth Amendment, that the tracking violated the Fourth Amendment, while also calling into broad question whether the third-party record doctrine makes any sense at all in the context of modern technologies, where in order to participate in modern life, we are constantly shedding information that is being collected by a wide variety of actors. So we have five justices on the Supreme Court that do think that this tracking, unlike in Carowin Knotts, did violate the Fourth Amendment, or rather was a search and seizure under the Fourth Amendment, search under the Fourth Amendment. But back to what Alito said. Alito's basic argument was, the reason for the name of our paper is he made a joke, which was, if the cops at the time of the founding, putting aside that there weren't really cops at the founding, full-time police is a modern invention, but at the founding, if someone were to be tracked for 28 days, the only way you could really accomplish that is if you had a really tiny constable who could somehow secrete himself into the trunk of your coach for 28 days. And of course, that's impossible. And in fact, even looking to modern times, just a few years or a few decades ago, it would have, as Ash has demonstrated, taken multiple cars and many agents and cost an enormous amount of money to do this kind of long-term tracking, such that one could reasonably expect that unless you were like a super criminal, no one would spend the resources to do that. It was simply practically impossible because of the expense. And so Alito said, and Sotomayor agreed, that is what defined our reasonable expectation of privacy in this case, the practical impossibility of it absent the new technology. And now that there is this new technology that allows it, we need the law to step up and protect us. The problem with Alito is that he didn't really draw a line about where we go from permissible short-term surveillance that was practically possible before, and longer-term surveillance that new technology has made possible. And so that's why we chose to write this paper, because we wanted to try and give some ammunition to what Alito was doing. Much of what Alito was doing is reminiscent of work that this gentleman has done, Orrin Kerr, in articulating what he calls the equilibrium theory of the Fourth Amendment, as where he describes the case law as a constant negotiation of the judges, where they are balancing increases in capability by the criminals and increases of capability by the cops to sort of maintain a rough equilibrium such that, you know, government power doesn't completely, you know, go out of whack, or the criminals don't go completely insane. He will articulate it much better than I am. But another academic who did some similar work articulated a concept that was very important to our paper called, what he described as structural constraints as a privacy right, or in more, you know, clearer language, perhaps, practical constraints. We have practical constraints, the way the world is built, that impact our privacy. For example, walls. We have walls. And you can't see through walls, and so those walls act almost like a regulation that protects our privacy. However, if we all had X-ray specs, or say if the government were to obtain devices that detected heat signatures, which in fact is the subject of a Supreme Court case, that would change the balance. That would actually reduce the pre-existing structural constraint that we relied on to protect our privacy. And the theory that Harry Cerdan laid out was basically for policymakers saying, we're in an era where technology is going to lead to a variety of these structural constraints that have protected our privacy dropping precipitously, with radical shifts in our rights as a result, and that it is important that the law keep up, that we replace those falling structural constraints with new legal constraints. And so we looked at that idea, and we looked at the decision, and we looked at the math that Ash had started to do. And to us, it looked like this is a major rights shift in terms of the drop in cost of tracking technology. And we wanted to quantify that. And we wanted to, as one commentator put it, Alito's decision seemed to be an empirical decision based on the falling cost of location tracking as an investigative method,
but it lacked the empirics. There wasn't actually any data there. So we wanted to provide that data. And that's what we did. And in doing that, and charting the drop in cost that you can look at in the graphics that that Ashkan put together, you can see really massive changes in cost, sometimes hundreds of orders of magnitude. But we came up with a rough rule of thumb that's sort of our canary in the coal mine for whether a rights shift has happened such that the court should step in and provide additional protection by requiring, by applying the Fourth Amendment. And we said basically, if the cost of doing the surveillance has dropped over an order of magnitude since the last generation of technology. So for example, if you were to compare bumper beepers with GPS, if there is a drop in cost of an order of magnitude, that probably means your reasonable expectation of privacy that you weren't going to be followed has been affected by that technology, and we need the Fourth Amendment to step in. So I mean, just to throw you some numbers as an example, one day of following you covertly in cars is 28 times more expensive than doing it with GPS. 28 days of GPS tracking is 300 times cheaper than doing the same thing with a bumper beeper. And so the concern and the need for Fourth Amendment protection increases as time increases. And so that sort of maps with what Alito was saying. You know, shorter surveillance raises less concern, longer surveillance raises more concern. But to bring you, and I'm almost done, and then we'll get to the commentators. I was struck by a recent example. Yesterday, AT&T released a transparency report that describes all the requests it gets from the government. Well, not all of them. There are some obscure numbers regarding national security. But when it comes to location tracking, they reported how many requests they got for real-time location tracking of cell phones in the first half of the year. Notably, there were over 12,000 of those for the first half of 2013. And those pen registers last 60 days, typically. Those orders last 60 days. So doing the math and looking at AT&T's costs, which are in our paper, they're actually pretty expensive. Sprint is like $30 a month flat, all you can eat. AT&T charges $100 for setup plus $25 a day. But so you do the math on the number of times AT&T tracked people in real time this year, the overall cost is $20 million. That's a lot of money. That is nothing to sneeze at. But if you compare it to what it would have cost to track those people in cars, it would have cost $5 billion, 250 times more money. And to echo the point that Ashkan was making, that would never happen. The FBI does not have those resources. It has never had those resources, but now, thanks to technology, it has all the millions of tiny constables it needs to follow you around all the time. Which brings us to my final point, which is about mass surveillance, such as what the NSA is doing. Our basic approach would, and is indeed meant to, ensure that Fourth Amendment review is triggered when technologies enable mass surveillance, because for most mass surveillance, it will end up incredibly cheap per person. You divide the cost by the entire population of the country. You could get to cents per day pretty quickly. So for an example, an original pen register like the one in Smith v. Maryland, again, was a physical box that you attached to a phone line. It was a retail technology, not a wholesale technology, and it cost money to do that. But we've moved away from that, and now we have IP-switched phone networks where we can install a splitter and route all that traffic into a surveillance box and place those around the domestic network and essentially have a pen register that runs on every person in the country. We think that that technology is so fundamentally different from the technology that the Supreme Court looked at in the 70s that it does require a new rule. And so so that's why we rewrote this paper. We do think the ideas that we put out in this paper, although it focuses purely on location tracking because that's what USC v. Jones was talking about, could be applied to other issues, drones. And I hope that we'll talk about a variety of different things that might be applied to in the comments. But now, the commenters. Thanks.
Oh.
Great. So I think we'll start out, I think, with Chris, if that's all right.
Sure.
Is that good? And do you want to come up here or stay?
I can sit here.
I think we're mic'd up.
It's more fun here.
Okay, great.
So I guess I will quibble with the math first, and then I will give you praise. How about that?
Okay. You did the math.
This is what happens when lawyers outsource things to other people. So I think really what this is about is marginal cost. This is about the cost of one more hour of surveillance, not the overall cost of surveillance. And what I mean by that is there are some technologies that have high upfront costs, high upfront capital investment costs, with relatively low marginal costs per each hour of use. And others, you know, okay, I suppose you have to train the FBI agent, but really what you were tracking there with the FBI agents was like their annual salaries, but with a Stingray that cost 150 grand, I don't see.
A Stingray is a brand of IMSI catcher.
Sorry, the IMSI catchers vary in price, but some of them are quite expensive, and I didn't see that in there. Cell phone surveillance cell phone surveillance performed with the phone companies is actually one of the few forms of surveillance where the capital costs have basically been borne by the people who are being surveilled, rather than the government. And so there aren't really any capital costs there. But so it would be nice to see you sort of focus a little bit or clarify the marginal nature of this. This paper really captures sort of the financial cost of surveillance, but the financial cost is just one piece of the puzzle. As you observe, you know, the FBI just doesn't have the manpower to be able to track that many people, and that's not just about it's not just about the money. It's not just that they don't have the money in the budget. They would have to divert resources from other places. And in many ways, the friction that the government has, the friction that keeps their surveillance powers in check, in many of those sources of friction are more than just money. They are the work of going to a judge and getting a warrant, right? So Bill Stuntz, the famous now deceased Fourth Amendment scholar, talks about warrants as a form of friction, as a tax on the government. And some of the technological advances that you guys chart are not just decreases in the financial cost, but actually decreases in the legal cost, right? So if with a Stingray, for example, the IMSI catcher, which actually sends signals through the walls of your house, Stingrays can be used in two ways. One is to locate a known phone, and then another is to identify all the phones that are in a given area or in a given house, right? And so pre-IMSI catcher, pre-Stingray, the police would have had to go into the house and search every person to locate the phones that were in use there. Post-Stingray, now they can sit outside the house with this magic device and figure out which phones are in the house. Not only is it cheaper, not only does it require less manpower, but now they don't have to go to a judge anymore, potentially, to go and use this thing. And there's
or
no
a phone company.
Or a phone company. These are unmediated forms of surveillance. Not only that, but it's not even clear that in the pre-IMSI catcher world, that a judge would have authorized the police to search 100 houses. There's no way that they could get a warrant from a judge to say, okay, we're going to go through this neighborhood. We don't really know which house the person's in. We just think they're in, you know, Northwest Washington, D.C. We're going to drive through every street until we get a signal back from his phone. There's no way they would authorize the search of hundreds or thousands of houses. But with this technology, they are now able to do things that they simply wouldn't have been able to do before, and with far lesser legal process. And I mean, I think that only strengthens your argument. This isn't just about the money. This is about the transaction cost. And as you noted also, you know, we seem to be going back and forth on this pendulum. Some forms of surveillance that take place now involve a third party. Other forms of surveillance don't involve a third party. The FBI following your vehicle doesn't involve a third party. The FBI going to Verizon or Sprint involves a third party. And you know, there are split opinions here as to the value, the privacy value provided by the phone companies. Probably the tech companies push back a little bit more than the phone companies. But, you know, right now, they're all we have. The lawyers who work for the phone companies and the outside lawyers who they retain, they're really the only thing we have, other than magistrate judges, to say no to the government. And my concern is that many of the most chilling and terrifying technologies that the government is acquiring, whether they're stingrays or IMSI catchers, whether it's the rise of hacking by law enforcement, these we're shifting back to unmediated surveillance where there is no neutral third party, And where there really is no one to say no to the government. And again, that's the reduction of friction and a barrier that previously would have been there and previously would have slowed them down and maybe would have said no. But otherwise, fantastic paper.
So do you guys want a second to respond to that at all?
I'll take the fixed cost. So absolutely on the fixed cost. We assumed marginal cost. So a lot of the equipment is actually purchased through grants, through the federal grants. And the assumption is, what is the barrier for one more, basically tracking one more person, right? So the assumption is they had to buy cars, they had to buy uniforms, they do buy this equipment, and they have this equipment. And so what is the legal barrier to track one more person? And that's the number we were looking at, but absolutely fixed cost is a number that can be a barrier. The assumption is a lot of law enforcement has some pretty sophisticated equipment or has access to.
I can agree with you on a few points. Surprise. I agree with and think it's important to conceive of going to the judge and getting a warrant as one of the costs we're talking about. And I think that highlights the need for when the literal cost does drop, in order to maintain equilibrium, you need to introduce new costs, and routing that surveillance through a judge is definitely one of the ways you could do that. And I also just want to second the point that you're making about how we are seeing a rise in varieties of surveillance that enable the government to directly surveil rather than having to go through an intermediary, whether it's IMSI catchers or drones or tapping into undersea cables or the like. And again, you know, people may have differing views on how good the companies have done at protecting our privacy, but like, I've worked with Mark on a variety of issues where they did push back. He represented Yahoo in the case that Jennifer mentioned, also a case in 2008 around government trying to get warrantless access to email. You know, in many cases, the companies have provided really important pushback that have helped us establish and defend rules for the road that protect us right now, including right now in the law enforcement context, the rule that they have to get a warrant if they want our email. But we're quickly moving to a realm of new technologies where that check isn't available. But I think that, again, sort of highlights our point that, well, then we need to make clear that there are other checks that they have to get checked, like the approval of a judge.
I should just add also that even though the phone companies are involved in the domestic metadata surveillance program that the NSA is doing, when the phone companies hand over the data in bulk, when they hand over everything, their role as the mediator of surveillance requests vanishes. They're not in the loop every time the NSA queries the data. And even if, as the president seems to be suggesting, the program may move either to the phone companies or to some third party, the scale with which the NSA is engaging in querying of that database suggests that there really won't be any practical barrier. The phone companies are not going to be able to actually analyze the number of queries that are being done and say, okay, we're okay with these ones, but not these ones. Whether the surveillance happens at the NSA, whether the surveillance happens with AT&T's systems directly, there'll be a technological interface to the phone companies, and the NSA analysts will just be submitting the queries without any phone company lawyer approving on an individual basis requests for analysis.
Well, and I'll just add to that, if we're talking about the falling costs of new surveillance modes and the new capacities that were practically impossible before, basically having a government-controlled time machine in which to go back and examine transactions that otherwise would not have been available to the government, like, that is a new and very worrisome capacity.
Good. So, yeah, I thought those were some good points. Your conversation made me think of something that I think would be good to mention, and it's the complexity, as I think you were all alluding to, that it's really unclear whether companies are going to push back or not. So even when you don't have bulk surveillance, there have been instances sort of with exigent letters, for example, several years ago, not too long after 9/11, in which agents were in fact, embedded with the phone company or vice versa, and there's not always that barrier there. So I think it's a really complicated question, just to throw another wrench into your conversation. So now we'll move on from the economic and technical argument to some more legalistic thoughts. Do you want to go next, Mark?
Sure.
Just go in a nice little order here.
I'll do it in the reverse order. Chris, I'll praise you first, and then I'll make five.
That's a good move, I think.
Five observations, which may or may not be in the category of criticisms or just observations. But the first is, I think you're onto something, right? I think you're, to try to quantify the when cost reductions amounts to a right shift, you know, is a useful exercise. And I think people will seize on it and use your work to try to make that argument. But when thinking about it, I think sometimes the right shift that we feel aren't about the acquisition of the information, but maybe the processing. So for example, we all expose our face every day to people when we walk down the street. Doesn't feel that intrusive, but when the people who are looking at us are wearing Google Glass and instantly doing facial recognition and comparing us to pictures on Facebook, that may feel much more intrusive, and the cost of acquiring the information didn't change. We go to an ATM, we know we're all being recorded. The cost of somebody sitting there to try to figure out who we are would be astronomically high. The cost of facial recognition technology, very low. Is that a right shift? Maybe, but we're talking about processing and not acquisition. The second observation is sometimes cost changes don't represent a right shift at all. For example, I've been representing providers, as you know, for 14 years. In 2005 or 2006, the OIG did a study and said most providers, at least in the telecom world, were charging the government about $2,200, $2,000 for a wiretap. And now, based on the responses to Markey letters, most providers are charging the government $200 or less even for a wiretap. So there's been a major change in cost, but the information the government's getting is no different. So costs just change without a right shift happening.
The number of wiretaps has gone up.
The number of wiretaps has gone up, although according to the reports, you know, the federal government isn't asking for that many internet wiretaps. But the point is I'm making is that there's a cost shift that's significant without a right shift whatsoever. Similarly, I'd say when you're talking about pen registers in Smithfield, Maryland, there was a cost there installing a device and recording the numbers dialed, and now our networks just pass the numbers dialed along with every phone call in terms of caller ID. So the costs are dramatically lower, but it hasn't affected a right shift. So I don't know a rule of thumb that says 10 times or 100 times makes a right shift really works all the time. It may vary depending on how much the technology changed in and of itself. The other thought I had is, you know, it really depends on what you compare it against. You went to the tiny constable and we went back to, you know, the 1700s, 1800s and comparing costs of something now versus then. We make marginal efficiency gains all the time. Law enforcement does as well. And the consequence of this theory would be, might be okay to erode our constitutional rights slowly as long as you don't do it quickly. Like, if you compare the $10 that Sprint was charging to the $100 in your analogy, well, that's not significant enough maybe to have a right shift. But it might be. It might be. We've just gone yearly. We've dropped the costs.
Yeah.
And that $10 is somewhat controlled by the provider. That is, we're looking at what Sprint charges law enforcement. So for a while, providers were criticized for being in bed with law enforcement by collecting funds from them for doing surveillance tasks. And now I think the pendulum has shifted where we see through your theories, in fact, that the provider's charges to law enforcement actually are a check. That is, to the extent the providers go back to charging $2,200 per wiretap, and you'd multiply that out for, you know, 1,000 wiretaps, you would have a very significant cost. So the providers control a little bit what law enforcement costs are, and they are, by seeking to recover their own costs, checking law enforcement that way as well. I think those are the major observations I had, except I guess one more, which is that sometimes the costs go down, but it doesn't feel that intrusive. Like in the Jones case, everything you said is correct. The cost is very low, but it's very low for a 3-day surveillance as well. And I don't know that the court would have said a 3-day surveillance was too intrusive in Jones. Yet multiplying the 3 days of the GPS monitoring compared to 3 days of a tiny constable or 3 days of a floating box, you would have the same cost variance. But I don't know that it would have been enough. The duration was independent of the costs, I think, to some extent. So again, I think you're onto something, but I worry that it starts to prove too much when we come up with a rule of thumb on a right shift.
Two quick points. The variance was assumed for 1 day, so that the numbers that Kevin was using were actually mostly 1 day numbers. The cost for, say, cell phone tracking for 28 days was something like 4 cents an hour, right, versus 250. So the math we were doing, and I agree with you as to whether if it was a 3-day search, US v. Jones would have come out the same. I think that's an interesting question. But I will say that the the costs we use were conservative. And then second to your point of processing costs, you're absolutely right that it's not just the cost of acquiring the information, but the cost of processing. But in a lot of technical realms, they're one and the same. I'll give you an example. I worked on a story with the Washington Post on the NSA collecting somewhere on the order of 5 billion records for location on a daily basis. And the reason for this technology was to be able to, at scale, identify whether one device was traveling with another device, right? And that's the ability to locate and identify all devices that their network had access to, and then compare the tracking or the kind of traveling behaviors of two devices at the same time, right? So the capacity from both collection and scale has changed, and I think that's, think about if there was, think about how to do that in prior to the technological capability. I don't think that capacity exists, and I think that's what we're trying to wrestle with, is how do you quantify that, and then how do you kind of adjust for that?
I'll start with your last comment. I mean, all of these are well-taken points. And I'll admit that we were certainly hoping it would have been very elegant if the math had worked out that it's less than an order of magnitude of cost difference for the first week or so, but then it crosses the line, because then we could have said, this is perfectly consistent with US v. Jones. It would have been great. The math didn't work out that way, although as Ash says, the numbers are pretty conservative. But I do think what the numbers show is that over time, the cost does steadily drop, such that the government's capacity to do broader scale stuff, like, there is a change in the cost such that one could imagine a legal rule tracking that. Like, so it didn't exactly work out that the line that we came up with as a rule of thumb, you know, rough line, dropped where we would want it to on US v. Jones. But I do think there's support for the general idea that as the price goes down, we need the legal protection to ramp up. Processing point, there's also simply the practical, like how to write that paper. How to write it in a timely way, what's the methodology for that, which technologies do we look at? You know, I would love to see more research on that. I'm probably not gonna do it. But I do think that overall, because one of the criticisms that we sometimes would hear when we were workshopping the paper was, well, when you have all that data, all that hay, isn't it gonna cost a lot to sort through all that hay? But you know, that's ignoring the fact that the technologies for processing are also getting better and faster and cheaper, such that you can do things like search every email that crosses the border for particular phrases, or data mine on cell phone records to see who's talking to who, you know, like that. And for not a whole lot of money, certainly for not a whole lot of money compared to what it would have cost to have a human do it. So I think all in all, the processing issue supports our general thesis. The what to compare against problem is another question that's come up a few times. It came up in criticism of Oren's theory as well, and so I basically cribbed what he had said in response and put it in a footnote in our paper. But basically, Oren, and again, he will describe it better than I, but in his equilibrium theory, to give a reference point, he talked about a notional year zero where basically things were in equilibrium. And this was criticized as being originalist thinking. And his reply was, well, year zero isn't necessarily and doesn't necessarily need to be, you know, 1776. It's just representative of what the last status quo was. And for me, the last status quo in terms of the Supreme Court's legal interpretations of the Fourth Amendment in regard to location tracking were Caro and Knotts. And so it seemed like the natural comparison point for this was Caro and Knotts, and before that was tracking without a beeper. We do get to a problem where there is continuous technological change such that what you can do this week is different from what you could do last week. But to the extent it is continuous and not like catastrophically huge changes that would represent a rights shift, I think there's an argument to be made that expectations can keep up with that, and that norms and expectations around the technology adapt. It's when the technology shifts so fast that our norms and expectations can't keep up, and that where we expect privacy but don't actually have it because we weren't anticipating that shift in the technology, that we actually have a problem that we need to address. So I think that covers many of your points, maybe not all of them.
Let's just stay with that one for one second. So that's an interesting point, which is if we had one set of privacy protections 10 years ago, and we have it gradually erodes every year, government can get more intrusive. When we get to now, we say no right shift has occurred because it took place over a course of 10 years. But if it all happens in 1 year, then a right shift has occurred. I'm more with the normative theory that either the right shift occurred based on the technology intrusion in year one or it didn't. It's not all relative to what happened the year before. Email should be protected. Whether email should be protected because marginally in the year before the government was able to get more of our communications or not, I don't think matters. I think email should be protected empirically based on a normative expectation of privacy in it, not based on a diminishing cost of government surveillance in it. Whereas if you just compare to the year before, the status quo erodes, then you don't end up with protection for
One quick point, which is email didn't exist, right? I think trying to focus on specificity of the technology is actually kind of misleading here. I think we should look at, for example, the type of information conveyed in these techniques and in these technologies and the types of information that law enforcement seeks to gain and do those comparisons on an apples to apples, tracking your location, tracking the content of your communication, focusing instead of the technology specifically on what it would cost the government to get that type of information, which existed in year zero, which existed, and then try to do an analysis on an expectation of privacy for that type of information, right, rather than try to focus on a technology. And then two, kind of just to echo Kevin's point, the expectation can kind of hinge on, I always come back to parking meters, right? So technology of parking meters, right? So we would not expect, the government could very well put a meter made at every single parking meter in the city or the country, right? And enforce parking the minute we go past our meter expiring, they could enforce. But we don't expect that, and it's not something that we would expect the government to invest resources into or to do. But technology enables them to do that, to exactly invest and achieve perfect enforcement of parking. And that's not necessarily something I think we want, right? I think we've designed parking meters as a way to curb parking in red zones and traffic zones and to get people moving, but we allow some kind of some slop there because, in fact, the purpose of it is to promote this public good, not to tax everyone for parking for over a meter. That's my theory, right? And so in the same way, technology affords this, has gotten so cheap that you could, in fact, surveil every single individual with whatever reasonable suspicion or standard of suspicion you have, such that you can enforce almost every law perfectly, right? And I think the question is, would we expect the government to do that? Would we expect the government to go after us if the technology does not exist? Would our expectation of privacy, say the government would come after me for a parking meter? No, right? They would not actually go after me for these purposes, and I think that's what we're trying to adjust to.
Can I ask a quick question of Mark as well? So you said that just over 10 years ago, a wiretap was $2,000, and today they're about $200. And I think that number, that shift is really fascinating. It's just, I don't want to let that go. So my phone bill hasn't dropped an order of magnitude in the last 10 years. But in theory, we have a highly competitive market for cell phone service in the United States. There's not a competitive market for wiretaps, right? If Aaron is being investigated by the FBI, not that he ever would be, but if Orange's an AT&T customer, it's not like Sprint can come in and offer a wiretap of Orange's phone for half price. AT&T is the only company that can offer a wiretap of Orange. And so you would expect that to the extent that there exists competition there, that competition wouldn't in fact be driving down the cost of surveillance. Now, I know that as a legal matter, the phone companies can only charge a reasonable fee. They can charge what the actual cost is, but their labor costs are going up over time. Why are surveillance costs dropping in this massive way when everything else in the industry is getting more expensive?
Well, I would think, and I don't represent a lot of phone companies, right? So I'm going by what's been reported in the OIG study and the Markey letters. But I would think the technology that enables the calls to be routed and captured and given to law enforcement has significantly been improved. And there's less troubleshooting required in order to deliver that content. and it's easier to find the subscriber across different networks than it was when they were roaming on different carriers' networks in the past, because of the nature of the network has changed. So I think those things have reduced the technology. The same way the technology has reduced the cost of surveillance for law enforcement to use, it's reduced the cost of the marginal cost of surveillance for the phone companies to use.
Thank you.
So I don't think it's a competition point.
I just want to stick to this issue for the moment, because I find it fascinating, the issue of what and how much the companies charge, and also how we talk about it. Because I expect they feel like they sort of can't win, because if they charge a lot, they're going to, you know, they will help, you know, chill some of the surveillance, which from a privacy perspective, as a privacy advocate, I think is overall a good thing. At the same time, though, they might get a lot of flack for like profiting off of surveillance or whatever. And so there are a number of different and interesting incentives. But I'm wondering, although it would hurt my argument in the, you know, our argument in the paper, you know, I would love to know why Sprint charges so little compared to the other providers, and like maybe we could convince them that that's not reasonable. Maybe you need to like you should up your charges just a little bit to be more on a par with what the others are charging. Because if what the others are charging is reasonable, like let's charge the reasonable charge and not have it be $30 all you can eat for a month.
I mean, but just because the law allows them to charge doesn't mean they actually charge. So Microsoft just started charging a couple of years ago, and that was because I and others were begging and pleading with them to finally start mm-hmm. charging. Facebook, it's my understanding, still doesn't charge. Mm-hmm. Facebook said that it would be that the work of getting the government to pay the bills was too much. I mean, the FBI has had wiretaps cut off in the past for not paying their bills. Now, Facebook actually has an advantage of every 7-Eleven in the country, you can buy prepaid Facebook credit for Farmville, and the police could, in fact, prepay for their surveillance. That's what you do when your customers don't pay their bills on time. You move from postpaid to prepaid. These companies should be charging. I think the solution to your problem of what do? You don't want to be charging too much and profiting. You don't want to be charging nothing and then not disincentivizing surveillance. The solution to that problem is to charge lots of money and donate the money to charity. Right? There's nothing requiring them to keep the money.
I think the government would have a problem with the lots of money point, because the government's view is that, you know, they can only charge a reasonable amount.
Reasonable,
and what people don't really know, and I'm sort of in the weeds and I don't think people really care, which is why they don't know, but for stored records, providers can charge the government a fee, and if the government doesn't agree to that fee, then you have to file a petition in the case, in the court where the case is pending. So in every single case all around the country, you'd have to say, you know, here's my fee petition. So there's incentive to sort of arrive with the government at what a reasonable fee is that they'll reimburse. In surveillance, it's not like that. That is, your CALEA rules say what you can and can't charge for. There's no provision to go in court in every single case. And it's unclear what happens if the government doesn't pay or the government thinks you're charging too much. So it's a very interesting area. The Department of Justice was supposed to issue some regulations on what providers could charge. They never did that. And so it's out there for every provider to do its own cost study to arrive at what the marginal cost of surveillance is, to then bill the government and then find out if the government's going to pay.
I'll just note one last thing on this point, which is really important. The sketchiest and most invasive form of cell phone tracking are tower dumps, where the government goes to the phone company and says, tell us everyone who was near this place at the time. And the cost of tower dumps doesn't scale with the number of people whose data is in that dump, right? And so one key attribute, if you want the cost of surveillance to actually disincentivize overcollection, is that there should be a marginal cost associated with each additional person. It should cost more money to get two inboxes than one inbox, and five inboxes than four inboxes. And the problem is right now, the government goes to Sprint and they say, we want a tower dump for this hour of time. And it doesn't matter if there were five people or a million people making calls through that tower, it's the same price. And so,
because the setting of the cost is based on the effort of the people at the company to set and deliver the content, and it has nothing to do with how many people are involved, because it doesn't go up marginally.
And so the phone companies need to find a way to engineer their systems such that the cost actually scales with the number of people. Sorry,
Oren. I have to press the button for every single person in this tower dump.
So on that note, I think Oren has been waiting patiently to offer his comments. One thing before Kevin gets mad at me, I was supposed to mention the hashtag for this program is surveillance costs, plural. So if you're tweeting, if you're tweeting out there, then that is the hashtag to use. And so, Oren, we'll wrap up with you, which is, I think, fitting, because your work is, this paper was partly based on your earlier work. So,
thanks. Well, thanks for the invitation to be here. I, I,
I think there are really two questions raised by this paper. One is, should costs matter to privacy law? And then if costs do matter, do we take a quantitative approach or do we take a qualitative approach? So I'm going to offer a couple thoughts suggesting that costs should matter, but that it's better to take a qualitative approach than a quantitative approach. So on the issue of whether costs should matter, here's the basic case for why I think costs are relevant inquiries, why this is sort of the right type of question to be thinking about. The basic idea is that we have the police investigate criminal activity, and we want them to investigate criminal activity when the benefits of an investigation outweigh the costs of the investigation. So the benefits of a criminal investigation would be collecting evidence of a crime that allows a successful prosecution, and we want that because there are all the aims of the criminal justice system in terms of deterrence and justice and retribution. Those can only be achieved if there is a successful prosecution. That requires evidence and that requires investigation. So we want crimes to be solved in order to achieve the ends of criminal law. That's the benefit of criminal investigations. And then there are two kinds of costs of criminal investigations. There's the internal cost, the cost of to the police of investigating the case. And then there's the external cost of investigations. Now, external cost of investigations is what we think of as privacy harms, right? It's the civil liberties costs of investigations. It could be the police breaking down somebody's door. It could be the fear of surveillance. It could be any of the chilling effect of surveillance. All of those effects of criminal investigations, all the bad things that are associated with them, are the externalities that are imposed by the investigations. And here I draw an analogy. In economics, it's common to talk about the classic example of a coal-producing or coal-burning plant, where the company that's burning the coal only has the cost of the coal to worry about, and there's all the pollution that's created by the plant, and that's an externality that's borne by the public. And so from the coal company's perspective, from the company's perspective, they have an incentive to overproduce because all of the social costs of their activity are borne on the public, not by them, and so they're going to over create more than they should. And you can draw a similar analogy in the investigative standpoint. If the internal costs are low and the external costs of investigations are high, the police will have an incentive to over-investigate. They'll use investigative techniques too much. And that's really where I think the insight about law enforcement costs matters. To the extent that costs are dropping, that means the internal costs on law enforcement are dropping. Those external costs per use of the technology are the same, and so we end up with the police thinking, okay, well, it's very cheap for me to do the surveillance. I'll do this much more often than I would if it were expensive, and that means that the police are going to do it when there's actually very little expected payoff in terms of law enforcement benefit. They're not going to reserve investigative techniques for cases where they really need it, it's an important case, they've got a lot of reason to think it's going to help solve the case. Instead, they might use the investigative technique just out of basis of a hunch or some sort of just in case it happens to reveal some sort of information. And that's more likely as the costs decrease, because then there's the incentives on law enforcement are going to change. So I think it's sensible in that context to consider the internal costs and the dropping internal costs and figuring out whether the law is going to step in, because the law effectively imposes that additional cost. It accounts for the externality by saying whenever the government wants to use this investigative technique, they need some sort of a reason to think it's going to work. What is the effect of a warrant requirement, for example? It's saying the government has to show that it's likely to work. They need to show there's probable cause. That is, give me some reason to think this is actually going to help solve the case. And then there's the particularity requirement. That is, show me that this is going to be a narrow search instead of a broad search. That is, lower externalities rather than you would occur with a broad search. So the effect of the law stepping in is effectively to raise the cost, act as sort of a tax on law enforcement to make sure that law enforcement is not overusing certain techniques in ways that are ultimately a social net negative, even though just based on internal costs, it seems like a hunky-dory great deal for law enforcement. So I think there's a thinking in terms of cost is really helpful here, and I think that methodology is a useful methodology. Let me then turn to whether it's better as a quantitative issue or a qualitative issue. I think it's a more effective approach when it's qualitative than quantitative, because I think trying to put numbers on these issues is just
too malleable for courts to actually try to grapple with. I mean, imagine you're a district judge and you get a law enforcement technique and there are arguments made about cost, and the costs have shifted, and therefore something that wasn't a search should be a search, or alternatively something that was a search shouldn't be a search now. Maybe costs have gone up. The union stepped in, the police department salaries are higher now, and so the government argues we should really make this conduct that used to be a search now a non-search because our internal costs are higher. It would presumably be a two-way street, not a one-way street, in terms of changing what is a search. And would a court have to consider that in each case and adopt a rule as to when they should say something is a search or not a search? If it's a quantitative approach, then you have to start saying, okay, let's introduce some rules here as to when something has to become a search or a non-search. And I think that's just too hard to do. These cases are just coming up in such different contexts, and it's so malleable as to what the costs actually count as. It's so easy to come in with different calculations. We would not want a case-by-case approach by which any prosecutor could argue that something that used to be a search is no longer a search, or any defense attorney could come in and say, well, something is now a search, and try to relitigate all of these questions of Fourth Amendment law in each case. In the paper, they sort of back off, I think, the quantitative approach by saying, it's not that it's a rule. It's that it's, maybe it's a rule of thumb, it's the canary in the coal mine, it's something to think about, this is when it should raise a red flag. I think if it's only a question of here's when there should be a red flag, well, we get red flags from intuitions, and it sort of reflects a sense of, wait a minute, something has changed. I don't know if we need to go through mathematical calculations, which themselves would be hotly disputed, in order to then say, okay, we've done the math, and there's been factual findings by the district judge about the exact changing, shifting cost of surveillance. Now we can hereby declare a red flag shall be raised. The canary is now died, and we should think of this issue. We now enter the thinking phase. I think it's much better to just say, listen, at the appellate stage or at the level of the Supreme Court, when the Supreme Court's allowed to rethink the direction of the doctrine, to say, we've just entered a different world in which this type of investigative technique is being used much more often than before, and therefore, we need to think about the role of costs and think about maybe the Constitution stepping in when it wouldn't have based on an earlier technological era. So one argument is this really quantitative, or ultimately are you sort of going back to, is it really quantitative, or really is it a qualitative judgment once the red flag has been raised? Another issue I wanted to ask you guys about is, so what's the role of statutory privacy regulation here? This is very much focused on constitutional regulation. So one argument would be that if a statute is passed, that effectively raises the cost of investigations for law enforcement. Does that mean, how does that get factored into the constitutional inquiry? Or would you just sort of have like some branch should step in and you use the cost methodology to, you ignore law, just focus on cost, assuming that there's no regulation, and then say somebody has to step in? Because it seems to me one argument that you could make using your methodology is, all right, if Congress steps in and regulates this, that clearly raises the effective costs of the police, and maybe then the Constitution doesn't need to step in. So you could have sort of a deference idea where if the legislature has acted, the Constitution doesn't need to act anymore. And more broadly, how would you deal with the question of statutory regulation and turning that into quantitative costs?
So. Sure. I'll take this middle point, and then you take the last point if you want. Just quickly on whether it needs to be quantitative. I actually agree with you. I think the idea was back of the envelope, and we kind of spitballed this rule of thumb as a way to kind of articulate this argument. And the real goal wasn't necessarily to find hard math or use an exact dollar figure, but it was a way to help kind of people that may not understand technology or try to concretely represent in a salient way what these changes look like, what the technology enables, and how that shifts, and use maybe some sort of metric to demonstrate what we all understand intuitively as a trend, some people more than others, some people with a better sense of technology than others. And one of the thinkings was, well, everyone understands money. Let's talk about money, right? That was just on the quantitative.
I'll start with your last question, which was about the role of Congress. Speaking generally, I think that this is an argument for policy changes from Congress as well. And Harry Certain's original article was focused on trying to explain this idea of structural constraints for policymakers. We expanded that to judges as policymakers, but you know, we would hope that like this kind of evidence would be helpful in convincing a legislature to do something if we had legislatures that did things right now. You know, but particularly on privacy, we're in a really frustrating position, and you guys know this as well as anyone. Like, the issue of, we were talking about earlier, warrants for email. We now have really strong precedent saying that the Fourth Amendment protects our email and requires a warrant. We have all the major companies requiring warrants and the government refusing to push them too hard for fear of going into litigation and getting another ruling saying that they have to get a warrant from the courts. We have, unlike many other issues, we have privacy advocates four square you know, lined up with the entire internet industry putting out a lot of resources to Congress to try and pass a law to make our current statute constitutional, because under, you know, under the way we view the Fourth Amendment and the way the courts are viewing it, the law is unconstitutional right now. And even with all those things lined up behind us, we still have yet not been able to get that to completion. I'm still hopeful of that, and we have some real champions like Senator Leahy helping us out. But I, speaking generally, don't, you know, at this point, I'm actually more hopeful of the courts moving faster than Congress, which is worrisome.
Let me push though a little bit. So it seems that the problem is that the privacy side has already won without a Supreme Court ruling or a statute. In other words, the practice is that warrants are required.
The practice is that with the big boys,
yeah,
a warrant is required.
Right.
And we just don't know what happens with the smaller companies. Certainly the government will ask for everything they think they should be able to get, and then we don't know, you know, that they can keep what they have and there's no suppression remedy under ECPA, right?
Right, but there is under the Constitution, so if a challenge is brought, that's one of the cases that could go to the courts, right? So
but the challenge has to be brought first. But I mean, at a practical level, there's the law as people who have really expensive lawyers follow it, and then there's the law as small companies without expert outside counsel follow it. And the fact is that there are plenty of small companies out there that are probably not following the same rules that Google and Yahoo are following.
But at least when the issue is raised, the result is that a warrant is obtained. And so this strikes me as one of these situations where you could argue, well, the cost of getting access to email is then effectively high because the practice is that a warrant is required. And so the warrant is already providing that. And maybe does that mean you don't need the constitutional rule because the practice is already existing? Or to what extent does the practice, are we focused on sort of just abstract cost, ignoring law? Are we focused on sort of what actually happens? Which is it that matters?
You know, our paper is focused on monetary costs. Like, your overall question of how do we factor in the existing legal costs in the analysis is actually one I don't have a great answer for. Like, that's something I want to think about. He's really helpful at bringing up things that are, you know, you need to chew on. But that brings us back to your initial question, which is like quantitative versus qualitative. And I guess I'd take issue with, why do we need to choose? Like, can't we try and address both, and can't one help explicate the other? You know, our modest hope with this paper was that someone moving to suppress location information would actually articulate a cost-based argument. Perhaps, and most likely, and frankly, hopefully, in conjunction with other arguments. Our less modest hope was that that motion might get granted. And then our, you know, insanely, you know, optimistic hope is that that would be upheld, you know, as it goes up the chain.
And you get cited.
And we get cited, yes, that'd be fabulous too.
And we meet Ginsburg.
And party.
Yes, and then, but, you know, you say that quantitative is too malleable, but like quantitative judgments about reasonable expectation of privacy, I mean, like that's one of the biggest problems in Fourth Amendment law is just like how unmoored that analysis so often is. I mean, you look at Smith, and particularly in the case of technology, where you often have judges who their thinking on the issue only evolves when they start using the technology themselves. I mean, one of the key determiners in Smith v. Maryland, the Penn Register case, was all the justices, when they grew up, you connected a phone call by telling that number to an operator. And so their natural inclination was, well, that's not private. And the fact that they automated it didn't make a difference. I was, you know, and so... And another key fact was a notice in the phone book about how the phone company combats fraud, from which someone, of course, would assume that they have the ability to record numbers. I mean, they're just drawing on kind of random stuff to support their conclusion that there isn't an expectation of privacy. So if
if there's any way to inject some quantitative rigor into that, I think that's worthwhile. And that was certainly the overall gist of what we were suggesting, even if, and you know, you're right to say this, we weren't saying like, this is the hard rule and this is the way it should be done. It is more of a thought experiment and a way of demonstrating that it could be done, rather than we absolutely think that courts really should follow a strict order of magnitude cost rule following these rules.
And I do think at the end when we touch on the 3,000 number, right, the fact that the FBI is able to simultaneously track 3,000 people's that the FBI has the capability to concurrently track 3,000 people, that quantitative number, I think, is a difference not just in amount but in kind, right? That's beyond what they would ever have capability to do without the technology. Right, and I think that informs, I think, the qualitative informs the quantitative. This is a different thing, right? If you could not ask, even for a manhunt, to ask 13,000 agents to not sleep, not go to eat and whatever else, and to try to track 3,000 people simultaneously would not actually be physically possible. You would either have to get a bigger budget or take resources off other agencies, whatever else, to do this. And whereas the technology is like, you can essentially, by sending an order to a company or a set of companies, they can do this.
Although, just one point, I've heard you speak on this before, even before you wrote this paper, and one of the things you used to say is metadata for one user is different than metadata at scale. And you didn't need a cost analysis to come up with that answer. Or Chris's point, right, whether a particular user connected to a tower is a different question than give me all the users who connected to the tower. And we don't need the quantitative math to feel that that's different.
But it supports that point. It's another arrow in the quiver.
It's another arrow in the quiver, I suppose. But I think the point is that you can get to that same conclusion by looking at the externalities and the number of innocent users affected or the widespread nature of the surveillance that's going on as opposed to the targeted nature without a strict cost analysis.
I mean, I'd be more sanguine about that if we actually had that answer from a court at this point, from a higher court. Like, until we actually get that answer, I feel like providing all the ammunition we can would be worthwhile.
There's just one thing I did want to say. I noticed there's some press here and being recorded. One is all my comments are on behalf of myself and not any of my clients. And second, I may have misstated the cost of wiretap. Now, I think 200 was the low number in the marquee responses, and it may have been between 200 and 500. Not fundamentally different to my point, but I don't want people to leave here thinking the cost of wiretap in the cell phone companies was 200 on an average. I don't think it was. I think that was the low end as opposed to...
Still too cheap.
Okay. So I think, do we want to make time for a couple of questions?
Sure, unless you have questions. But yeah,
I mean,
I think I would like to open it up to the audience to see if you guys have questions. If not, I certainly have some, but yes.
I'm Greg Minton, I'm here with myself. And I just want to ask some questions about the other side of this, which is defending against surveillance. This is going, you were tweeting earlier about agencies and PS and some of the journalistic companies and news organizations that aren't using it.
Do you want to use the mic for the people at home?
Sure. You were talking earlier on Twitter about companies that weren't using it, like The Guardian, Al Jazeera, and their certificates that have expired. Frankly, from the outside, that seems like half-assed measures. And why is it that they just don't seem like they're caring that much about that $30 to renew their certificate?
So let me try and answer your question in a way that brings it into what we've been discussing on stage. So what Ashkan and Kevin really have been focusing on is the cost of the government spying on you. And there are technologies that you can use to raise that cost as well, right? So in the case of your cell phone, there's nothing that you can really do to make it more expensive for Sprint to track you. In that case, it's binary. Either the phone company can locate you or the phone company cannot locate you. And what the things you have at your disposal are basically turning off your phone so that it no longer functions as a phone. You don't really have a lot of control there, but for other forms of surveillance, for surveillance of your financial transactions, you can maybe use an anonymous or pseudo-anonymous currency. For your internet activities, you can use encryption technologies and anonymity technologies to make it more difficult for the government to track you. Now, I personally believe that if you are the target of government surveillance, the game's over, they're gonna get what they want, one way or another, particularly for the National Security Agency and the FBI and agencies that have a lot of resources. Maybe the local cops don't have quite those resources yet, and maybe they never will. But I think what you can do, particularly for internet-based surveillance, if you are not a target, you can raise the cost such that wholesale dragnet surveillance will no longer affect you in as significant a way as before. But I want to make it clear that there is this like gigantic asterisk, which is that this doesn't apply to cell phones. Everything sucks with cell phones and privacy. And that's just simply because of the laws of physics. Like, there's no way to hide from the cell phone towers. But I do think that we can meaningfully raise the cost of dragnet internet surveillance. I don't think that the NSA should be able to get everyone's emails. I don't think they should be able to look and see everyone that's visiting a news organization, which we learned they were doing this week to WikiLeaks. So as their costs are going down, we need to do everything we can to raise them back up again.
But as somebody who works for a news organization and tries feebly to raise the cost of surveillance, there's a cost then that you're paying yourself. And so I think that that is important to consider as well. I don't think we want to necessarily make it difficult for everyone to use the internet, which...
So there are some privacy protecting technologies that are so unpleasant to use that even if they were financially free, no one would actually use them. And but
many of them are.
Many of them are. And you know,
most.
The only journalists who have started to use email encryption in the last year or so have done so because the threat was finally clear, and the writing was on the wall. And some of them had to have how-to videos made for them by Edward Snowden. But you know, the legal profession isn't quite there yet, even though the writing has been on the wall for some time for them. I think that encryption of web traffic is a no-brainer. That isn't end-to-end. It's you to Google. It's not you to your friends that you're communicating with through Gmail. But it is easy right now for every organization to deploy HTTPS encryption such that your university, your employer, your internet company, the government won't know which articles you're reading on that site. I think that's like a very modest goal, and generally what I try and focus on are things that are within reach, and that's totally within reach now.
And just quickly to bring it back to phones, Chris is kind of very adamant about this topic, and I worked on a story on this topic. There are encryption technologies for your cellular communication as well. So the carrier has essentially the equivalent of, say, HTTPS for your phone, A51, A53 are some of these technologies. But what they do is they make it more difficult for law enforcement using off-the-shelf equipment, like the ones we talked about earlier, to record the contents of your conversation.
Right? Without the help of the phone company.
Without the help of the phone company. So they can get your communication by either going to the phone company and requesting the contents of your communication, and the phone company then has to divert resources or divert your calls and record them, or they can sit outside your house with a van and one of these systems and record your conversations. And there are encryption technologies that can be placed, that the phone company can use to prevent the latter, the sitting outside with your van. But we've been seeing slow adoption, for example, in the US at least, of these encryption technologies, at least the ones that would thwart this type of free surveillance.
So I wanted to touch on one thing that I thought was particularly interesting about your paper, and it was that you were focusing on location, and I can understand why you did that, but that resulted in this very nice, neat chart and so forth, but there are so many other technologies that are being surveilled now, and I'm curious to hear about what thoughts you guys have on how this might apply to email, other types of surveillance that might not be quite as neat as location.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
although it's not in our paper, we did look at drones.
Because
in our original
everyone
draft,
loves drones.
And you did the huh?
Everyone loves drones.
Yeah, drones are awesome. I mean, scary, awesome, both. I kind of want one, don't we all? And looking at the cost of that, and you know, actually, funnily enough, right now when we have drones that require a human operator to do most things, the difference in cost actually wasn't that different from, say, someone following a bumper beeper operating an IMSI catcher.
One agent versus two.
Mm-hmm. But we are going to get to a point where you could have a cloud of autonomous drones covering an entire city. And I think that, you know, the court that thought thought that 28 days of tracking a car was problematic would probably also have a concern with, you know, a ubiquitous perpetual surveillance platform that could track everybody over all time in public, which is actually, I think, where the technology is going. And in fact, it's where the technology is right now in certain parts of the globe where we are deployed. You know, there are these drones with like multiple massive cameras that are pointed everywhere and that can cover miles at a time. And so I think that, you know, as I hinted in my comments and as we hinted at the end of our paper, I think that that kind of surveillance, which would basically reduce the ability, you know, reduce the cost of tracking people through a city, not only to pennies a day, but like infinitesimal fractions of pennies, you know, a year, would certainly trigger our red flag and just kill the crap out of that canary. Pardon my French. As I mentioned in my comments, also the example of mass pen registers, I think, would also do that. Basically, anything that implicates the privacy of millions of people is probably going to raise our red flag.
Although, so I would pivot just slightly, and we touched on this a little bit before about busting down the door and going into someone's house. I think Chris was talking about it. I would focus less on the people and cost of acquiring the type of information, right? So we have different technologies that cheapen the cost of acquiring, say, the location of someone, but for example, acquire the contents of their communication. We thought about, you know, one thing that I did in an early kind of back of the envelope was looking at cameras, right? So like the UK has a pretty extensive grid of cameras, and that actually changes the cost of identifying or surveilling people from a visual surveillance perspective. I could always hire a team of people to follow Oren around in a van, but having a grid of cameras that are kind of perpetually present and able to record his activities, whether he robs a store. I've heard you do this a lot. Whatever you may be up to, that changes the cost of the cameras themselves. Email surveillance allows you to, rather than go to the post office or go and break into your house to get your letters, to go and capture your communications off the wire, off the provider. Cloud storage is a great one, right? So cloud storage obviously changes the cost from, again, going into your house, going through your affects, right, going and doing a black bag job of going and trying to get your stuff, to just like going to Google and either hacking your account or getting that information with a legal requirement from Google. So there's definitely a number of avenues you could look at, but essentially the general trend is that technology changes our ability to access information, both at scale as well as the ease with which we can get that information, the convenience, both from us as individuals as well as for, say, law enforcement.
So do we want to have snacks now, or?
Another question.
Other questions?
Okay. Yes.
Let's see. Hi, I'm Caitlin, and I work for GW's Cybersecurity Policy and Research Institute. And this question is not related to the institute at all; just my own. You all talked about norms, and the phrase rights shift was thrown around. And I just want to poke the bear a little bit more and get your opinions on. Do you think? do you think that a norm cascade is possible for laws and policy related to privacy and surveillance, or do you believe that technology grows so rapidly and changes at such a pace that it can never truly happen?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question one more time?
I'm sorry, I'll go. Sorry, it's kind of a mouthful. We talked about norms and a rights shift. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering if the panel, what your thoughts are on, do you think a norm cascade is ever possible for laws related to privacy and surveillance, or does technology change at such a rate that this cascade could never really happen?
So I'm not sure what you mean by a norm cascade.
Norm cascade to me is it's just a time when everything kind of goes across the board and everyone jumps on board and says, yes, this is an issue. Mm-hmm. Right now, I would think that the NSA leaks are kind of jolting people into wondering what we should do. But my brain tells me everything changes so quickly with technology that I just don't know if it can happen.
I mean, it may be that we have a norm cascade that addresses what we found out about, while there's also other things that are happening that we haven't found out about that we'll find out about in 10 years and we won't have been able to keep up. I mean, I think your comment highlights, I mean, the problem that this paper and countless others is trying to address, which is policy making turns on us both recognizing and understanding and reacting to changes. Therefore, the response necessarily lags to some extent. And I think that with technology, both because of its complexity and because of how fast it changes, policy processes are that much slower in terms of keeping up. That is, if anything, that may be the fundamental crisis of the 21st century, or this millennium, which is how do we figure out what the structures are that will keep up with the problems that technology creates while also taking advantage of the benefits that technology brings. I am not the philosopher king who can answer that question. Certainly, I think finding ways to quantify that change and demonstrate it to policymakers who may not be familiar with the technology is a critical part of that. I want to optimistically say that I think we can keep up in a way that keeps us from driving off an existential cliff. But I'm not yet convinced of that. But like, if I didn't believe overall in that project, I probably wouldn't do the job that I do, which is all about trying to keep ahead of that game.
Are there other questions?
I'm going to ask one just because I have this esteemed panel here, and kind of thinking out loud, kind of something back to what Oren, you had said, which is this internal math of cost benefit analysis that you do, that law enforcement does, that we want law enforcement to do, of whether a particular line of inquiry or investigation is likely to yield a outcome that is kind of beneficial and worth the cost. And kind of thinking out loud, and this is more less in the law enforcement context, but more in the kind of surveillance that Kevin's been speaking of the NSA surveillance. How do you model or think about a cost-benefit analysis when the kind of you're tasked with kind of at all costs, right? And so the mandate is not prevent terrorist attacks, or the mandate is not try to keep them down. The mandate is essentially you can have zero, we should have zero terrorist attacks. At all costs, you should prevent any other attacks on U.S. soil. No, like in terms of, from a computer science perspective, you have this thing of like uptime and service level agreements. You have to have 99.999% events, like you have to have zero events of terrorist attacks. And so for people that are like the NSA, for people operating in the IC, intelligence community, trying to decide whether something's worth investigating, how do you kind of do that cost-benefit analysis in a way where you've been tasked to do everything at all costs? So how do you come up with a framework for that?
You know, I'll try and throw something in there. I don't have the answer here, and Mark may know the answer, but he probably can't tell us the answer. The NSA for a period of years was engaging in bulk surveillance of internet metadata too. It wasn't just the telephone metadata that they're still doing to this day. And we don't have the full story of what happened there and what led to them stopping that program. But under questioning, they have said that they've said the reason that they no longer do it is because it wasn't really giving them bang for buck. The NSA has this pool of money. It's a very large pool of money. I think, $10 billion a year or something?
53.
Sorry?
53.
For the NSA or for the IC?
IC.
So the IC has a very large budget. And they have to figure out how they're going to spend that budget. And certainly surveillance that's cheap means that they can do lots of it and then spend the remaining money on things like spy satellites that are really, really expensive. But I think there is some kind of like bang for buck decision and decision-making process that takes place. And if we take them at their word, which we probably shouldn't because they keep lying to us, maybe they decide to abandon programs when they're no longer worth their cost. The problem is the cost goes down over time, and many of the forms of surveillance they can do involve initial collection at a certain fixed cost, and then they get to data mine it after the fact for many different forms of information. And so you know, the NSA decides to collect cell phone location data, or to collect cell phone records, and then from that, they can mine call records, they can mine location records, they can mine location records to see where the targets are, they can mine location records to see who's co-traveling. And you know, my concern about the way that we know the NSA is doing stuff is, once they have the data in their database, many of the really sketchy things come from the searches. They say they acquire for this limited purpose, and then this like mission creep comes in where, oh, we've got this data. The UK government, you know, has data on every web query coming through the United Kingdom. Let's see who's looking at WikiLeaks' site. Let's see, you know, in real time, which videos are getting the most likes on Facebook, because they just have this data there.
I just make one observation. I don't really think it can be an at all cost mentality. If it was an at all cost mentality, they wouldn't observe the rule at all, law at all, right? They just say, well, we don't need to worry about that, and there's no risk to us. The costs that they consider are the costs of, you know, they do consider the costs of public approbation when it comes out, the individual liability if somebody exceeds, you know, what they believe to be the legal mandate. There are costs in when providers push back and they have to decide that, you know, they're going to fight or not fight when the provider push back. You know, you've heard about a particular fight that may not be all of them. They may have decided to let some go. So there are costs. It's just they have a lot of money. So it's not the financial cost, maybe that's the full cost-benefit analysis, but there are a lot of externalities, as Oren was talking about, that I think figure into their analysis.
And just to clarify before you respond, to Chris's point, I don't think it's this, like, I have fire insurance, right? I've never needed to use it, right? But it's still cost-effective for me to have it because, you know, it's such a catastrophic event, and I want to avoid it, that I'm going to keep it, and I'm going to probably hopefully never need it, but I'm going to cover this space. And I've under this mandate, under this kind of rubric where you, like, the public will not tolerate and we, you know, the administration will not tolerate any other attacks, how can you have this kind of, this analysis? Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question of sort of, you said this is the mandate, and I guess I push back a little bit and say, well, who says that that's the mandate? Are we saying sort of that's what is believed within the executive branch? Is that what the president says? Is that what the policymakers are actually thinking? Is that what the public thinks? I think absolutely it's true within the executive branch. The mindset is we should do anything within the law and within our budget, within our powers to eliminate the chance or minimize the chance of a catastrophic terrorist attack. Absolutely right. I don't think when the public decisions are being made, or even when the decisions are being made, you know, what should the classified budget, you know, the black budget of the United States be? I don't think the thought is cost is no object, that we should make it as high as is possible because, you know, I think there's always more that could be done, and that's reflecting some sort of judgment that's being going on of, okay, they're diminishing returns at some point. So I guess I wonder if in reality that is, you know, to the extent the mandate means like a commonly agreed upon view that we all share. I guess I wonder if that's actually the case or whether there aren't, I tend to agree with Mark, there are cost judgments being made and values and trade-offs being made by decision makers all the time.
Well, and I'll just add that speaking of the trade-offs and the cost-benefit analysis that applies to the NSA programs and what their benefit is and what their costs are, for more on that, tune in next Tuesday at 4 p.m. where we'll be having an event right here on the costs of the NSA programs to the internet industry, to the taxpayer, to internet security, and to our foreign relations.
Look at that setup.
Yeah, well done. Very good.
Thanks for that.
Good job. All right, well, thank you so much, guys. I think we have some refreshments in the back. And this was enlightening, and I really appreciate your inviting me to moderate. And thank you guys so much for coming.
Thank you so much, Jennifer.